Friends, I'm used to praying before I give a lecture, so will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the immense privilege it is to be yours. We thank you for the gospel of the Lord Jesus. We thank you for salvation freely given and secured forever by his blood. And we thank you for those who have gone before us, who have proclaimed that truth, so that we in the end might hear it in our time. And tonight, as we think again about events long ago, we pray, Father, that you might stir our hearts, stir them with the wonder of the gospel that these people believed and passed on to us. And so, Father, give us all that concentration we need. Help me to speak what is true and to your glory, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. May I say thank you very much for having me. It is an enormous privilege to be here and an enormous privilege to give a lecture in honour of Clive West, who I met several times and whose memory lingers as one who was faithful himself to the gospel of the Lord Jesus and one who encouraged others to take the gospel to the world. On the 31st of October, 1517, Martin Luther nailed a notice to the northern door of the castle church in Wittenberg. It was a notice of debate, a debate that would never actually be held in the end. It was to be an academic debate, but the issues at stake were much more than academic. They concerned the nature of the Christian life and the availability of forgiveness. Oh yes, they were also about the power of indulgences and the authority of the Pope. But Luther's vision was much larger and not purely negative or reactionary. In these theses, he began to develop a positive vision for the Christian life, the place of repentance, faith, and the gospel of Christ. Now, I say began because the 95 theses themselves are not a consistently Protestant document. At the time, Luther was still operating within an essentially Catholic framework. However, alongside an earlier document of his disputation against scholastic theology published a month before, a trajectory was being set that would lead to sweeping change in the lives of Christians all over Europe and the world, and we still feel that impact 500 years later. Now, it ought not to surprise us that some have suggested that this is not an anniversary worth celebrating. Some decry the resulting division. Of course, there had been major lasting division before the Reformation, most notably in 1058, when the Pope and the Patriarch of Constantinople anathematized each other. But throughout Europe, there had been only one church. And now, after the Reformation, there were several denominations. Was this not an assault upon the unity of Christ's church, for which he prayed in his great high priestly prayer? Some opposed the doctrine that was championed by the reformers, the doctrines of justification by faith alone, the priesthood of all believers, the authority of Scripture over all church pronouncements, predestination and the sovereignty of God in all things. Some claim the Reformation was a mistake of which we should all repent. Some point to the bloodshed and the violence of the era and what was unleashed afterwards. The religious wars of the 16th and 17th centuries played a major role in undermining Christian witness in Europe, paving the way for skepticism, Enlightenment rationalism, and the secular materialism and atheism of our own time. So we're bound to ask whether we should rejoice in this anniversary. Is the Reformation something to be happy about? Something to be proud of? Is it still relevant? Does it still speak today? Does it still matter? Should anyone other than historians get excited about it? Well, I hope you won't be surprised to hear me say that there are very good reasons to celebrate the Reformation on this 500th anniversary. To start with, the Reformation remains, for all the assaults upon it over the last century in particular, one of the landmark and seminal events of human history. The events, the ideas, and yes, the men and women involved are among the most interesting and influential in all human history. What they set in train literally changed the world. About 20 years ago now, when my wife and I were coming to the end of our time at Oxford, a friend from Australia dropped by one Saturday morning. We just literally opened the door and there he and his wife were. And they'd been touring around England and were just about to head home. But my friend Bruce, that really was his name, Bruce, he wanted to see two more things before he left. He wanted to see the cross on the road where Archbishop Thomas Cranmer was burnt for his faith, and he wanted to see the monument that's known as the Martyrs' Memorial. For those of you who don't know, the Martyrs' Memorial is a monument that was erected in 1841 in memory of the Reformation martyrs Cranmer, Latimer, and Ridley. But it was also a protest against the Tractarian movement, which sought to return many Roman Catholic practices into the Anglican Church, and it was based in Oxford. Well, my friend wanted to visit it, and he wanted to take a photograph or two. So I offered to take him down the road. So Catherine stayed behind, I took him down the road, and he brought his camera bag with him. What happened that morning was memorable. There was a protest happening that day against landmines. And the protesters had placed single shoes on each of the steps of the memorial and had put a big placard right across where the plaque on the Martyrs' Memorial was. My friend was initially disappointed, but he was undeterred. He went over to the lady who seemed to be in charge and he politely explained that he'd come 10,000 miles to take a photograph of this memorial and would she mind moving some of the things so that he could take the photo. He promised that he'd help her replace them afterwards. Well, muttering, not really under her breath, the woman started removing the shoes and then the sign. My friend walked across the intersection so he could take the photograph. And when he was in position and everything was taken down, he stood up to take the photo and his camera wouldn't work. The battery was dead. So he had to walk across the intersection, go and get a new battery, and then walk. You can imagine what the lady in charge was thinking. Well, after he'd taken the photo, Bruce came back and, true to his word, he began to help her put the shoes back in place. But she waved him away, saying things like, "This is exactly the thing we don't need in Oxford. No one wants this," she said, pointing at the Martyrs' Memorial. And when it was clear that she wouldn't let Bruce help her put things back, he started to go away to the cross around the corner. And as she shouted at him, he turned around and said, "But you'll enjoy the freedom they died for, won't you?" In that little exchange, you see the contrasting reactions to the Reformation today. Something we would do best to forget, something we should be embarrassed, almost ashamed of, or on the other hand, something worth celebrating, something that brought in its train a remarkable freedom that impacts believer and unbeliever alike. So tonight I want to tell you why the Reformation still matters. Why it's not something to be embarrassed about, not something to be ashamed about, and why we should be celebrating with full voice what God did then and is still doing today. And I have 5 points to make. It matters because of the change that was made. It matters because of the doctrine that was taught. It matters because of the blood that was spilt. It matters because of the error that persists. And it matters because of the gospel mission that remains. And I hope you don't mind if I'm a little self-indulgent and major on Luther. After all, he was at the centre of the events in 1517. So first then, the Reformation still matters because of the change that was made. One of the things I love about the Reformation period is that it was a period when faith and life were tightly interwoven. You could tell almost immediately upon entering a house whether it was a Catholic home or a Protestant home. And it went way beyond simply the crucifix on the wall. In more wealthy Protestant families, there would be a family Bible in pride of place. The father's role as a spiritual leader of the household was a lot more obvious. He led prayers in the home, read the Bible to his wife and children, saw his life's work as a vocation and family life as a means of honouring the Lord. He took church attendance seriously and made sure the rest of his family did as well. On the other hand, in the conscientious Catholic home, there was most likely to be a family shrine with a crucifix and a set of rosary beads, perhaps a missal as well. The sacraments under the control of the church would be much more prominent in everyday life, and there would be a clear sense of the religious life as distinct from the life of ordinary people. You see, the Reformation produced a revolutionary change in the homes of ordinary people. The single celibate life was no longer the Christian ideal. The Christian family became the centerpiece of a new piety, the arena of a more earthy and far less remote understanding of discipleship. The Reformation dramatically touched the everyday lives of people, and it made a difference. Stephen Osmond's little book, Protestants, The Birth of a Revolution, has a delightful chapter on the impact of the Reformation on family life, and another one on the religious beliefs of teenagers in the Reformation period. The late Professor George Yule used to deliver a lecture with slides on the impact of theology on church architecture to make very much the same point. He would show the interior of a medieval church with its prominent rood screen, which separated off the holy area in which the priest and the choir did their bit, from the body of the church, an empty space where parishioners would gather and stand around gossiping and transacting business, and much else besides, stopping every now and again to cross themselves when they heard the bell and lining up to receive communion, the communion wafer only, never the wine, when the procession came out of the sanctuary to offer it to them. The divide between the religious life and ordinary life was embodied very dramatically in the architecture of the building. Inside the sanctuary, the central place was given to the altar, with its finely coloured coverings and often a large crucifix or painting of the crucifixion behind it. There might also be statues and pictures on the walls of the church as teaching aids for the people. However, as Reformation became official policy in cities and regions on the continent and in England, churches were stripped of altars and images, rood screens were dismantled and removed, walls were whitewashed. In Lutheran churches, the pulpit, the baptismal font, and the altar were all put in the front of the building, word and sacrament kept together, the liturgical action all happening in the same place. Sometimes even they'd put things on top of one another. You'd start with the altar down the bottom and then a pulpit on the second floor and an organ on the top floor in some churches in Germany. In England, altars were replaced with tables. Some instances they were put in a separate room, the communion room. In the centre, at the front of the building, was the lectern, to which was chained a copy of the Great Bible, an architectural reflection of the priority given to the reading of the Word of God in Anglican services constructed by Thomas Cranmer. To the side was the pulpit, though in some churches, influenced by more Puritan emphases, the pulpit replaced the lectern at the centre. Things would move back in the other direction again with the ascendancy of the High Church Party in the Church of England in the 17th century, and especially after the restoration of the monarchy, when there was a more liberal attitude towards Catholic liturgical practices. The relationship between the church and the state was transformed by the Reformation. Luther had early on called on the princes in Germany to reform the church if the church wouldn't reform itself. And this opened wide the door for state influence in church affairs. The Peace of Passau in 1552 set in place the principle that whatever the prince believed is what the people believed. The state embodies the religion of the one who rules. And that cemented this relationship between church and state in Germany. Earlier, Henry VIII of England had insisted that the Pope properly had no jurisdiction in England, and that the king had responsibilities before God to govern the affairs of the church as much as any other sector in the Commonwealth. He would title himself Supreme Head of the Church of England on Earth. The Convocation did, however, insist upon an important caveat: as far as the law of God allows. For good or ill, the temporal authorities had more say and influence in Protestant churches than they had ever been able to have under the Church of Rome. And that's saying something, because there'd been a reasonable amount of political interference in church affairs across Europe prior to the Reformation. In England, church attendance, church services, the requirement of confessional subscription, and sundry other things were legislated by the Parliament with the approval of the monarch. So family life and the architecture of churches, the relationship between church and state, the nature of ministry was also changed as a result of the Reformation. Ministry in medieval Catholicism was fundamentally sacramental. The priest, by virtue of his ordination by a bishop in the apostolic succession, was a dispenser of divine grace. The centerpiece was, of course, the Mass, in which, through his prayer, the elements were transformed in substance to the body and blood of Christ, and the sacrifice of Calvary was repeated, or at least represented. Yet there were six other sacraments as well, not to mention the provision of the sacramentals, things like holy water, as conduits of divine grace. This ultimately amounted to a system that reinforced dependence upon the church and the offices of the church from the cradle to the grave. Only from the priest could one gain forgiveness and the assurance of forgiveness. This elaborate system is what Luther attacked in his little work Prelude on the Babylonian Captivity of the Church, and others who followed him would do a more thorough job assessing the practice of the time against the teaching of Scripture. In place of this priority of the priest and the sacramental acts, the Reformation returned the Word of God to the centre of Christian ministry. Again, in the crucial year of 1520, Luther had thundered, "One thing and one thing only is necessary for Christian life, righteousness, and freedom. That one thing is the most holy word of God, the gospel of Christ." It is the word of God, Luther argued, and not the laws of the church or the exertion of the reformers themselves, that genuinely changes lives. The pastor is principally a teacher, because without the word, faith is not called forth and the Christian does not mature. Of course, there were other things besides the weekday and Sunday sermons for the minister to do, but they were all decidedly applications of the word of God to everyday life. In England, you might know, Cranmer and his colleagues produced a lectionary as a means of systematically and extensively exposing the congregation to Scripture. The reforming archbishop was convinced that regularly hearing and reading the Word of God would change the individual, change the congregation, and eventually change the nation. And that's why his liturgy was saturated with Scripture. Now, one other factor is worth noting. The Reformation created an entirely new social phenomenon, the pastor's family. Of course, there'd been a scandalous practice of clerical concubinage prior to the Reformation. Though a vow of celibacy was required for ordination, some parish priest houses were served by housekeepers who mysteriously kept having children. There were generally known fees which could be paid to the local bishop to overlook such irregularities. In one play written by a German man, Nicholas Manuel, the priest's play that was presenting what was happening in church, priests who were unable to contain themselves simply had to pay 1,500 gulden to the local bishop and could have as many children as they like. However, the Reformation turned things on its head and brought with it a new celebration of marriage as a holy and joyful gift of God. Luther himself married Katie von Bora in June 1525. But actually, long before that, back in 1519, when Luther was preaching on the wedding of Cana in John chapter 2, Luther spoke about the singular gift of marriage. Have a listen to what he said. Natural love is that between father and child, brother and sister, friend and relative, and similar relationships. But over and above all these is married love, that is, a bride's love, which glows like a fire and desires nothing but the husband. She says, "It is you I want, not what is yours. I want neither your silver nor your gold. I want neither. I want only you. I want you in your entirety or not at all. All other kinds of love seek something other than the loved one. This kind wants only to be the beloved's own self completely. If Adam had not fallen, the love of bride and groom would have been the loveliest thing. Now this love is not pure either. For admittedly a married partner desires to have the other, yet each seeks to satisfy his own desire with the other, and it is this desire which corrupts this kind of love. Therefore the married state is now no longer pure and free from sin. The temptation of the flesh has become so strong and consuming that marriage may be likened to a hospital for incurables, which prevents inmates from falling into graver sin." Not exactly the happiest of images, is it really? I'm not sharing that one with Catherine. Yet even in the face of sin and the very real potential for distortion and abuse in our own interests, Luther could still say, "Oh, what a truly noble, important, and blessed condition the estate of marriage is, if it is properly regarded." He'd go on in the same sermon to speak about the value of raising children. Listen again to what he says. "It is of the greatest importance for every married man to pay closer, more thorough, and continuous attention to the health of his child's soul than to the body he has begotten, and to regard his child as nothing else but an eternal treasure God has commanded him to protect, and so prevent the world, the flesh, and the devil from stealing the child away and bringing him to destruction." Now, Luther and his Katie were not a Hollywood love match, at least not at first. Actually, Katie was one of 12 nuns that Luther tried to find husbands for from a particular nunnery, and he could find husbands for 11 of them, but couldn't find husbands for this 12th one, who was a little bit opinionated, and so in the end he married her. Both Martin and Katie saw marriage as a vocation, as an opportunity to rejoice in the good things that God had given, an opportunity to spite the devil who didn't want them to enjoy the good things of God, and strangely as a form of iconoclasm, tearing down the image of the aesthetic holy man whose value lay in what he denied himself. But love did come, and they built a genuine ministry home characterized by a warm and generous hospitality. There were almost always guests at the dinner table. Poor Katie was always looking for more food to feed people. People were gathering around taking notes about what Luther was saying while he was eating. The Luthers demonstrated a joy in life and a seriousness about the faith that was a model to others. So the Reformation dramatically changed life at home, life at work, and life at church. Christian theology and Christian living were more closely aligned with the teaching of the Bible. And for that, each one of us owes profound thanks to God. The Reformation still matters because of the change that was made. Secondly, the Reformation still matters because of the doctrine that was taught. Luther and the other reformers did not think they were inventing new doctrine, but rather recovering the doctrine taught in the Bible. Yet these recoveries, if we should call them that rather than discoveries, these recoveries radically challenged what was being taught by the Roman churches and opened up new vistas for faith and hope and love. At the centre, as far as Luther was concerned, was the doctrine of justification by faith alone. It's of this doctrine that he famously remarked, "When it stands by this article, the church stands. When this article falls, the church falls." He would insist that on this article of faith rests all that we teach and preach against the Pope, the devil, and the world. Why was this doctrine such a big deal for Luther? Why did he conclude that everything rested on it, on this one doctrine? Luther recognized, of course, the prominence of justification by faith in the New Testament. That in itself ought to be enough for someone to consider it important. Yet he also understood that this doctrine sits at the intersection of three great areas of doctrine. The doctrine of justification by faith has profound implications, firstly, for theology proper, our understanding of the nature and character of God himself. For you see, Abram's question still stands. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is right? How can the God who is perfect and just and holy set someone like you or someone like me in the right? Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is right? The Apostle Paul himself brought these two things together, the doctrine of justification and the character of God, when he wrote that the propitiation by Jesus' blood was to show that God's righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. You see, for Paul and for Luther, the character of God is at stake in the doctrine of justification by faith alone. That's why it's critical. The doctrine also has profound implications for Christian anthropology, secondly, our understanding of human nature, particularly under the conditions of human sin. Our situation is more dire than we ever want to admit. We are not just slowed down by the fall or by the choices that we ourselves have made as heirs of the fall, but such is the impact on our will that we are unable to do anything to assist our own salvation. In Paul's language, we're not just sick with sin, but we are dead in our trespasses and sins. The problem is that you and I, and our culture generally, tend to be incurably optimistic about human nature. And that optimism makes a difference to the way we think about our good works, the way we think about church and what we do in church, our assessment of what's happening in the world around us, and what the world's greatest needs in fact really are. Luther understood that the doctrine of justification by faith alone must mean that the problem we have is there not just when we are at our worst, but when we are at our best. The very best we can do in our own strength condemns us. We have absolutely nothing to plead before God but Christ, and we can never have anything to plead before God but Christ. Our condition cannot be overcome with our own resources. We cannot even make the slightest bit of progress with our own resources. Our total helplessness is the necessary corollary of justification by faith alone. And if you don't believe that, the doctrine begins to unravel. As just a bit of an aside here, when eventually in the 16th century, the greatest mind of the era was enticed to write against Luther after years of pleading from the Pope and his officers, Desiderius Erasmus wrote a diatribe on the freedom of the will. It's not one of the great works of Western literature, yet the response Luther penned stands out as one of the best things he ever wrote, The Bondage of the Will. In his conclusion to that work, Luther praised Erasmus. This is what he said. I give you hearty praise and commendation on this further account, that you alone, in contrast to all the others, have attacked the real thing, that is, the essential issue. You have not wearied me with those extraneous issues about the papacy, purgatory, indulgences and such like, trifles rather than issues, in respect of which almost all to date have sought my blood, though without success. You and you alone have seen the hinge on which it all turns and aimed for the vital spot. As far as Luther saw, Erasmus had seen the critical point of difference between Luther's understanding of the gospel and that of the Roman Church. Luther insisted that an entirely false understanding of Christian life and ministry had been built on an optimistic anthropology, the assumption that there was something, no matter how small, that we can and so must do to prepare ourselves for the grace of God. And Luther's point is that justification by faith blasts that to smithereens. We are incapable of pleasing God, incapable of meriting God's favour, even just in part, because every part of who we are is touched by the consequences of the fall. Our thinking, our emotions, our words, our actions, our personalities, our decisions, our will, and even our genes. Although he didn't say that. It is a dangerous delusion to think otherwise. You will never really entrust yourself to Christ, Luther knew, unless you despair of yourself. A proper understanding of ourselves is at stake in the doctrine of justification by faith, and that too is why it's critical. And need I say, that is why it is so offensive to so many people today who are deeply invested in saying there's nothing fundamentally wrong with me, or the way I think, or the choices I make. The doctrine of justification by faith alone, thirdly, has profound implications for our understanding of salvation. It is this doctrine, as much as any other in the end, that points us to Christ, and Christ alone as our Saviour. We might say that the central purpose of the doctrine of justification by faith alone is to guard, protect, and direct us toward salvation by Christ alone. Without it, we will instinctively add other things to his work, our best efforts, the ministrations of the church, our personal devotion. It is important in this connection to insist that faith is not something we do, another kind of religious work, but is itself the opposite of doing, the opposite of works. Faith involves a recognition that I have no works I can plead before God, and my only hope lies in Jesus Christ. It's a wholehearted trust in the only one who can save me. Paul would insist to the Ephesians, by grace you have been saved through faith. But then he added, and this is not your own doing, it's the gift of God. Salvation is a gift that comes to me entirely from outside myself, from him, and it is from beginning to end an act of grace. The salvation Christ won for us on the cross is not just a top-up, not just a supplement that makes up for the gap between my performance and God's standard. It is complete and entire and outside of myself, and it is God who makes it mine by his Spirit bringing faith to life. This is the life-giving truth of the gospel. It gives confidence and freedom, and frees us from the feverishly trying to protect ourselves or promote ourselves. It makes genuine assurance of salvation a reality, because it's not up to how much I do or how well I do. And that, Luther recognized, is why this doctrine is critical. Now, I've concentrated on justification by faith alone because that's the doctrine that Luther saw it as at the heart of it all. At the very centre of the disagreement between Luther and the Roman Church was a different understanding of the gospel, a different understanding of what salvation is and how it comes to us. And if this was the only doctrine that was taught by the reformers, it would be ground to say that the Reformation still matters. But if we had time tonight, we could look at other crucial doctrines recovered by the reformers. Firstly, that our knowledge of God, his character, his will, and his plan for his people comes from his written word, the Bible. And that this scripture stands as judge over every pronouncement of human beings, no matter how learned they are, no matter how many qualifications they have, no matter what position they hold, no matter how many of them there are. Scripture is the final authority. It alone is the word of the living God, which has the right and power to bind the Christian conscience. Remember the words of Luther when he stood before the emperor and the representatives of the Roman Church? Here I stand, I can do no other. The words just before that, my conscience is bound by the word of God. Later generations would talk about this as sola scriptura, scripture alone. Or secondly, that every Christian has direct access to God in Christ through his word and does not need an intermediary, either in the form of a priest, the church, or the saints. We've been given the inheritance of Christ and can call God Father. Our faith is not dependent upon a human institution or the faithfulness of a human authority, but on the faithfulness of God displayed in the giving of his Son in our place and for our sin. This would later be developed as the priesthood of all believers. Or thirdly, that the church is a congregation of faithful men and women in which the pure word of God is preached and the sacraments duly ministered according to Christ's ordinance, to use the words of Article 19 of the 39 Articles. The church is then a creature of the word, brought into being by the gospel and for the gospel. So it's a mistake to think of the church in organisational terms or in terms of a hierarchy of offices. What matters is the gospel is preached in word and in the tangible word of the sacraments, and that faith in Christ shapes our life together. To have all the trappings without the word, without faith, is to have an empty shell. And Luther could use very colourful language about empty shells. And there are others, of course. The doctrine taught by Luther and Zwingli and Calvin and Cranmer, and by many others, including Melanchthon, Bucer and Bullinger and Tyndale, amounted to a radical return in a whole variety of areas to the teaching of Scripture. Luther himself believed it was a release from spiritual oppression. So wonder afresh at a salvation won completely and entirely for you, secure and immovable, because it's anchored in God's character and Christ's sacrifice and not your own performance. Wonder afresh at that again tonight and realize that the Reformation really does matter because of the doctrine that was taught. But there's a third reason. The Reformation still matters because of the blood that was spilt. The truths we've just been talking about cost people their lives. Such was their joy and excitement at the recovery of the New Testament gospel of grace and free forgiveness, which does not depend on good works, but instead makes genuine good works possible, that they literally staked their lives on it. They were the Reformation martyrs whose courage and faithfulness to the cause of Christ in and of itself makes this anniversary worthwhile. The first Lutheran martyrs in the Reformation were Johann Esch and Heinrich Voss, who were burnt at the stake as heretics in the marketplace at Brussels on the 1st of July 1523. Interestingly, when Luther heard the news, he's reported to have said, "I thought I would be the first to be martyred for the sake of this holy gospel, but I'm not worthy of it." was not unexpected when it came. The persecution of the evangelical movement in the Netherlands had been going on for 2 years. Luther wrote a letter to the Christians in the Netherlands in which he comforted them by remarking, "You have now become so strong and productive that you have watered and strengthened the cause with your very blood. For among you, those two precious jewels of Christ, Heinrich and Johann, have held their lives of no account in Brussels in order that Christ and his word might be glorified. What a little thing it is to be put to shame and to be slain by the world when those who are so treated know that their blood is precious and their death dear in God's sight, as the Psalms say." I wonder whether you know that the martyrdom of Esch and Vose led Luther to write his first hymn. Wrote loads of hymns, but the very first hymn he wrote, the very first hymn of the Reformation, was entitled, "A New Song Here Shall Be Begun." The first stanza reads this: "A new song here shall be begun, the Lord God help our singing, of what our God himself hath done, praise honour to him bringing. At Brussels in the Netherlands, by two boys martyrs youthful, he showed the wonders of his hands, whom he with favour truthful so richly hath adorned." They were, of course, not the last to die for the biblical doctrines which Luther had brought to light and challenged the Roman Church. John Fox would immortalise their stories in the admittedly polemical Book of Martyrs. The first English martyr was Thomas Hitton, a clergyman who'd been working with William Tyndale to smuggle portions of the English Bible into England, who on the orders of Thomas More was burnt at the stake on the 23rd of February 1530. Less than a year later, Thomas Bennett was burnt at the stake in Devon for denying the supremacy of the Pope. Thomas Bilney, trusting in Christ alone, denied the mediation of the saints, and so was burned at the stake in Norwich on the 19th of August 1531. John Frith was burnt at the stake on the 4th of July 1533 after insisting that neither the doctrine of purgatory nor of transubstantiation could be proven from the scriptures. But the four most famous English Reformation martyrs were William Tyndale, Hugh Latimer, Nicholas Ridley, and Archbishop Thomas Cranmer. Tyndale was hunted down, most likely on the personal orders of the king, finally captured in Antwerp, strangled and burnt at the stake on the 6th of October 1536. His crime? Translating the Bible into English. His last words were reported as, "Lord, open the King of England's eyes." Bishops Latimer and Ridley were burnt together outside the city walls at Oxford on the 16th of October 1555. Thomas Cranmer was forced to watch from a window. Latimer is reported as saying to Ridley, "Be of good comfort, Master Ridley, and play the man. We shall this day light such a candle by God's grace in England as I trust shall never be put out." Only months later, Cranmer faced the same fate, famously putting his hand that had months before signed a recantation first into the flames. But there were others, men and women. Some would claim Anne Boleyn as a martyr of the Reformation. She was certainly Protestant, as her letters show, but there were, of course, other factors at play in her case. Similarly, Lady Jane Grey, the 9-day Queen of England. However, Anne Askew only preached and wrote Reformation doctrine and was tortured and then burnt at the stake for it on the 16th of July 1546. It's reported she had been injured so much by the torture she endured that she had to be carried to the stake on a chair. The courage of men and women like that, born out of their conviction that the Bible's message of salvation in Christ alone must be heard, and that those doctrines which diverted the attention of men and women elsewhere must be opposed with the loudest voice, is another reason why the Reformation still matters. And speaking personally, I want to say that the Reformed Church of England, or Church of Ireland, or Anglican Church of Australia, is worth fighting for not because of institutions and structures, but because it was established at the cost of these men and women's lives. The insipid liberalism that characterises so much of Anglicanism worldwide today needs to be challenged because the cost of the Reformation settlement was so high. Well, that leads me very much more briefly to the last two of my five reasons. The Reformation matters because of the error that persists. Despite a century or more of ecumenical endeavour, the theological differences between the Roman Church and Protestants remain today. Many of the external abuses that were rife in the 16th century have been addressed, that's true. But the doctrine of the Roman Church remains unchanged, despite 500 years of argument from the Bible. Now, ecumenical statements often obscure this sad reality. But every time there appears to be a convergence of doctrine, it proves to be not because Rome has revised its teaching, but because those who have represented the Protestants have given ground, or at least been prepared to take refuge behind ambiguous language. Careful reading shows that the Roman Church has not moved at all. The era of a church authority structure that stands alongside and often over the scriptures, the era of a justification that accepts a role for faith but puts it alongside human effort or achievement in one form or another, the era that puts Mary and the saints alongside Jesus as heavenly intercessors, and in Mary's case, the immaculately conceived co-redemptrix, the era of a priesthood that sees its role as dispensing grace through the sacraments, all seven of them, all of these still persist in the Roman Church. Out of love for each other, we need to recognise that simple fact. The Reformation, you see, was far more than a tragic misunderstanding. There is indeed much that Roman Catholics and Protestants believe in common. But the things on which we differ really do matter. They make a difference both now and into eternity. And the differences are still there. The Reformation is not over in any sense. The call to come back to the teaching of Scripture, which of course we need to heed ourselves, of course, is still needing to be made. And finally, the Reformation still matters because of the gospel mission that remains. The Reformers were concerned to see men and women brought to faith in Jesus, to see them grow in godliness and in a life of faith worked out in their everyday situation. Their world was very different to ours, not least in the fact that most people were considered, at least formally, to be part of the church. It was very hard to self-identify as an atheist or an unbeliever in the 16th century, since the state would apply its gruesome sanctions if you did. So much the opposite of today. Yet the Reformers were not so naive as to think that everyone in their city, region, or country was converted. They knew too that it was only as the gospel was proclaimed with clarity and biblical faithfulness that men and women would repent and put their trust in Jesus. It was only as they came to despair of themselves and see the wonder of what Jesus has accomplished that they would be drawn by God into his kingdom. The Reformation was a gospel movement, in a very important sense, a missionary movement. Luther was convinced that the Roman Church had locked the real treasure of God, the treasure that God has given us, away from the reach of men and women in desperate need. Releasing the gospel through faithful preaching and faithful living in the light of that faithful teaching would, he believed, make a difference. And it did throughout Europe and around the world. The mission was essentially the same as the mission of the first disciples, taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. But it had to be the true gospel, the Reformer said, the real thing. Not something encrusted with human traditions which obscured its glory, muffled its voice, and emptied its power. God is sovereign, and his purposes will prevail, but he has made known the means by which that will happen, the bold, clear presentation of the gospel of the crucified and risen Saviour to a needy world. So precisely because of this mission, the Reformation still matters. The Reformation still matters because of the change that was made. It still matters because of the doctrine that was taught. It still matters because of the blood that was spilt. It still matters because of the error that persists. It still matters because of the gospel mission that remains. But was it worth the price of division? Let me conclude with just three simple observations about this charge that is considered by some the knockdown blow against the Reformation. The first is that truth matters and error is dangerous. Truth matters and error is dangerous. That's true generally. It's all the more true when we're talking about truth and error with regard to God and the way he saves people. Division is almost always painful, but sometimes it is necessary. When human lives and futures are at stake, it's more cruel to turn a blind eye than to confront the error, even if that means division. Of course, we ought not to pursue division. We have no business being pugnacious, always spoiling for a fight. But to pretend that division is not tragically necessary on occasion is not only unrealistic but cruel. The second thing to say is that this division was never sought by the reformers. Luther never believed he was setting up a new church. He saw himself as a faithful member of the church that stretched back to the apostles. He was calling to the church he loved to be true to its heart, true to its Lord. He sought the welfare of the church and not its demise. And that was so across the board, with the possible exception of some of the extremists, from whom Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, and Cranmer would all have distanced themselves as well. Luther actually spoke of being abandoned by Rome when he was trying to do it good. He spoke of his threefold excommunication when released from his vow of obedience by his father confessor, when excommunicated by the Pope in Rome, and when condemned as an outlaw by the emperor at the Diet of Worms. He didn't leave the Roman Church. The Roman Church left him and proved itself in his eyes to no longer be the Church. But the point is, the Reformation was never initiated in an attempt to break away from Rome. Thirdly and finally, while we grieve at the way it played out in the century or so after Luther, and it was surely never right to harm or persecute or murder each other, the array of denominations that eventually resulted is actually a good thing. It's made room for freedom of conscience on matters about which Scripture says little, and allowed genuine fellowship in the midst of disagreement. Many of us will have experienced the reality of fellowship with people of other denominations. Anglicans with Presbyterians, Baptists with Lutherans, even Protestants with believers who for various reasons remain within the Roman Church. We do not have to agree on everything to have genuine fellowship, and we can extend a generous freedom of conscience to others who differ with us on things about which the Bible is silent, or where the Bible itself gives us freedom, such as when to baptize people and how much water you use when you do it, or what form of church government is best, or whether you sing only psalms or use contemporary songs of praise as well. As long as the gospel is believed, as long as the supreme and unchallengeable authority of Scripture is maintained, both in teaching and in practice, unity can exist alongside and across institutional distinctives. And in that sense, division, if you want to call it that, can have a positive edge as well. Friends, 500 years on, The Reformation continues to impact us all. Our world is to some measure still shaped by it. And Christian men and women are able to rejoice at what God did through very ordinary, frail and fallible people who were given the good work to do of standing up for the gospel when it all looked dark around them. The slogan of the Reformation in Geneva was, "After darkness, light." In what sometimes looks like encircling darkness in our own time, there is even more cause to thank God for what he did in the 16th century and plead with him to do it again for the sake of his beloved son. Why don't we pray? Heavenly Father, we do pray. Thank you for all that you did in the time of the Reformation. We acknowledge weak and fallible people just like us who made mistakes just like us. But we rejoice at the recovery of the gospel. We thank you, Father, for those who staked their life on it. We thank you for the changes that were made to everyday life by the gospel impacting everyday life. And we want to stand up for your truth today and commit ourselves afresh to the gospel mission today, knowing that what you have done through Jesus has not only changed our lives but holds out hope for all who will come to him. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.